Good morning, everyone. I have this strange sense of deja vu, like we've been here before. Up next, we have Lily Tang Williams. She's running for U.S. Senate in Colorado. She's a former state chairwoman of the Libertarian Party of Colorado, and she's an immigrant from mainland China, where she learned the dangers of the Chinese communist education system. And she's here to warn us against where things are going here in the United States. Lily Tang Williams, folks.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you very much. This is my first time speaking at the National Convention. And I am Lily Tang Williams, living in Parker, Colorado. My husband is here with me. And we have a full-time job to do in Colorado. So let me ask you a question before I start. How many of you have you been mainland China? How many of you speak Mandarin? Ni hao. That's the first word you should learn when you plan to travel to China. That's easy. Besides water, beer, 啤酒, right? So anyway, I'm going to show you a map of China if you have never been to mainland China to show you where I come from. So I was born 2 years before Mao's Great Cultural Revolution. You can figure out my age by now if you know the history. So if you look at this map, Chengdu is southwest of China next to Tibet. So Sichuan province is a very mountain state. That's why I'm a mountain girl. I love mountains. And I traveled to Shanghai when I was age 17 to go to Chinese law school because I had a big dream to transform China from society ruled by man to society ruled by law. That dream never come true, by the way. This is a few pictures of me as a toddler on a horse. In a country where Communist Party controlled everything, they also control little photo studios. You pay the money, you go to little room, so the government workers can take pictures for your family. You have to pay money, which was expensive to us. And my aunt never took picture before. This little girl here, she insisted to be in the picture with us because when you take picture, it's like a holiday. So she wanted to be part of our family. Later we had a little baby brother. So we had a family of five. My mom and dad worked for state factories 6 days a week, that time in China. And they still could not keep us fit. The government issued food stamps to us. You know, so you can go buy whey flour, sugar, and a bag of potatoes. We had 2.2 pounds of pork per month for family of five during the Cultural Revolution. You can eat one meal today for that much meat. And my dad worked for state factories to be steel, for the steel enterprise. And he was an orphan at age of five. So my grandparents died when my dad, as youngest seven children, become orphan. So he never went to one day school. But he's always very hardworking. You know, he was adopted by his uncle, so he could have some food. And so he started to work on the farm since the age of five. Something you don't know about Sichuan people, their reputation is first to rebel, last to submit. Maybe sounds like Texas?
Yeah,
so my dad is that kind of person who would rather scrub toilets instead of kissing communist boss butt, right? So he fought his communist boss all the time, and they tried to get rid of him after he worked for them all his life. When he was age of 40, his boss said, "Mr. Tang, I'm gonna send you to countryside, another remote location to work. When you actually work for Chinese government, when they relocate you, the army move you. They do not move your entire family." So my dad would leave my mom, who is often ill and three children home. He said, boss, I cannot do it because I just have to take care of my family. They said, well, you have another option, retire at age of 40. My dad thought, hey, you know what? I'm strong, I can work for myself. I can fix bicycles, I can pedal tricycles, like you say here, you know, it kind of reminds me of my dad's tricycle, you know, when you have three wheels, you need to pedal passengers. And so my dad retired, and he wanted to start his own business. Guess what government told him? You have to get permit, and we cannot give you permit because you are a retired worker. My dad said, well, my income is not really enough to feed all my entire family on a retirement income. They said, well, we got to reserve those permits for younger people who don't have jobs at all. So my dad was forced to become an illegal worker on the streets of China, Chengdu, and basically fix bicycles and transport passengers in his tricycle. Many times he was robbed. One time his nose broke, and he ran into hospital, could not report to police because he was illegally working. A few times, the city workers come to confiscate all his equipment, his tools, his bicycle, and his tricycle, because he was illegally working. So my dad had to save money, start over again, you know, borrow from relatives to say, I got to keep going. So without my dad, I probably could never afford to finish my 4 years college, law school, which is 4 years college in China at that time. So I'm forever grateful for my dad who made so much sacrifice and to work illegally. Now you should know how I feel about government regulation. You need a license to cut hair, sell lemonade, all the stuff like that. Taking your rights away and then sell back to you. That's how I see government license is. This is a picture of me, first grade class. Here's me, not happy. I did not wear a red scarf on my white shirt. Here's a story at age of 7. I was really confident. You know Young Pioneers, which is a grassroots mouse organization for primary school students. It's such an honor, such a privilege to join Young Pioneer. So I got a little bit too confident. I told my girlfriend, I better be the first one to join Young Pioneer because I got the best grades for the subjects. She told my teacher, and then my teacher said, come on, let me talk to you. I'm not gonna nominate you to join Young Pioneer, she said. Why, teacher, I'm the best student. No, you are not humble enough. Your confidence, your individual expression are not allowed in our collective society. You need to act, you need to behave like everybody else in the society. I wasn't happy. I told my parents. My parents were also brainwashed to say, I agree with you, teacher. You should be humble. You should be like everybody else. So at age of 7, I was denounced next day in the class in front of all the other students. My teacher criticized me, told me too confident, not humble, and decided to pull me back, not to join Young Pioneer for a year. I was so humiliated, I was so embarrassed. I wish I could have dug and hide just under the table. And I learned, do not trust anyone. That time at the age of 7, keep everything to myself, keep my private thoughts to myself so I can move up in a collective society. I was smart enough to figure out that's the only way I can get promoted. I can wear a red scarf. That's a lesson I never forget at age of 7. Here's my elementary school pictures of my teachers. She's the one who lectured me, and this teacher, her title is a political counselor. She does not teach any subject. Instead, her job is to make sure every morning when we go to school, we will chant, long live Chiang Mai Mao, long live Communist Party, I love my motherland, then we sing a song you saw in the movies. Literally, we sing a red song to thank my mom, thank the party. There's a famous song called Mom, Father, a Deer, but the more dear is cheer my mom. Mom becomes like our God, our Jesus. We had to worship him every day. We had to write diary every day to confess our thoughts to cheer my mom. So I learned quickly, you better not to say anything wrong in your diaries because you turn over for teacher to review every day. And you're supposed to report your family members, your neighbors, and your friends who are not conforming, who say something not politically correct. And it was that kind of society I lived through during the Cultural Revolution.
Oh,
1 year later, I wear a red scarf. Look how happy I was. I truly become a believer. I had no other information. I did not know what the world is like. I just knew to be happy, to be promoted. I needed to become conformer. I need to say all the political correct things and do all the right things and write great diaries to move up. This is something you probably see in the movies all the time. Literally, I ordered recently from Amazon English Chinese version of Chairman Mao's quotation book. We had to memorize all those quotations in elementary school. I even didn't know what they mean. I do remember a political power comes out from a barrel of gun. That's what Chairman Mao said. And this is a picture of the Cultural Revolution girls. I was one of them. I was not in this picture because of, you know, taking pictures is expensive back then. And look at those girls. You're supposed to wear unisex clothes. Bright red color like this is banned. It's not political correct. So most time, if you want to look pretty at little girls, you just wear a little inside shirt. Maybe have some flower, have some color, and still risk to be criticized. Girls are not supposed to look like girls. You have approved haircut styles. Hair like this, past shoulder, is not politically correct. You will be accused to be capitalist at that young age. So we had to wear basically green, blue, white, and we have approved hair colors, ponytail, pigtail, or just a short, ugly hairstyle like that. You look like boy. And don't ever talk about boys. Sexuality was a strictly banned subject. And I feel guilty until today. I was class president. When a little girl, my friend, received a love letter from a boy at a seventh grader, she runs to my place, tell me, what should I do with this letter? I said, of course, I'm going to turn over to a teacher. It's my job. I gave to my teacher. That boy got probably criticized and lost. I could not even face his face because he was so depressed and just wanted to socially withdraw. I don't know what my teacher said to him, but of course I did not know until now. What I did was horrible. But hey, I was one of the many believers, just thought that was the right thing to do. And the probably girls never received love letter from him ever again. And this is typical Cultural Revolution pictures. The Cultural Revolution, of course, is 10 years political social chaos started by Chairman Mao to purge his political enemies. But once Chairman Mao used the Red Guard and he sent them to countryside, said, hey, you guys have become so violent, now it's time to go down to countryside to learn from parents. Schools were shutting down. And I tell college students today, when you're trying to silence the others, and you'll be silenced later by your government later. That's exactly what happened to Red Guard. This guy is Mr. Wang, who actually was the president of Peking University. He had to be house arrested on school campus by his students and come out, denounce him and criticize him every day for about 6 months. He was wearing this pipe car called the Counter Revolutionary Revisionist, Wang Yilun, that's his name. You know, in Chinese government schools, we had no sports, we had no gym. So of course, you know, favorite Chinese sport is ping pong. Actually, that was only fun we had. If we want to play any kind of sports, I become elementary school ping pong team member. Because that was the only way I thought someday I might go abroad. I might go abroad to see the world. I always wanted to see the world by reading all the, you know, world novels. They translate into Chinese. And that was my only fun to play ping pong and practice every day and focus on that. I was laughed by my neighbors. Oh, she's got big dreams. She wants to go abroad someday. I did not care. I was focused on my dream to be a best ping pong player. I still challenge my kids, hey, beat mom today, $30. They have not beat me yet. This is my uncle. He was 17 years old when he was sent to countryside. My grandmother has 3 sons, 1 daughter, including my mom, so 5 children. My mom is oldest. So when you have young teenagers in the home during cultural revolution, when mom wants them to go to the countryside, you get to keep your youngest child in the family home. So my grandma lost 3 children, 3 sons, almost like overnight. People say, what if you don't send your children to countryside? How dare you? You lose your job, you get a public denounce, you'll be wearing a pie car, and you might risk to go to prison. You have no parental rights, you had no choice. When Chairman Mao said, time to go down the mountains, this uncle, my beloved favorite uncle, went to border with China and Burma for 10 years. He was 17. I was an elementary school student. I had 9 pennies to give to him because I knew I only could see him once a year. And he was a very sad generation. When they tried to come back to cities to say, government, let us come back to cities. We suffer enough. And they were totally silenced. How did they come back later? They had to write posters with blood on the wall, on their posters all over in China to say, if you don't let us come back, we're going to kill ourselves. So they plotted a massive suicide on the railway, on the railroad tracks. That got government attention. So they say, okay, young kid, you can come back. If your parents retire, give their job to you. So my uncle eventually come back at the age of 27. No diploma from high school. Health was ruined. He's still working today in his 60s now. He's very bitter. He said anti-government stuff all the time. His daughter is very worried to say, Dad, be careful. They're going to come lock our door. He said, I have suffered enough. I don't care. So he becomes very anti-government today. But most people still don't get it. They suffer enough, but they don't conceptualize what happened to us. Who did this to us? They will talk about their past sometimes just with laughter, trying to laugh that off. It's like, because they've been in China all their life. They don't know what to think of it. And they don't do anything to take action to improve, you know, China's freedom environment. You know, even my friends today, they are still indoctrinated. They tell me, my message in America is very radical. My friend trying to advise me, come on, really, our life under Chairman Mao is not too bad. When you are indoctrinated all your life, it will take your lifetime to reverse it. So don't ever, your kids and grandkids in this country, to be brainwashed by U.S. government. We were very sad when Chairman Mao died. I was 12. So from 2 to 12 was 10 years cultural revolution. When he died, we cried our eyes out. We really thought he was like our God, you know. How could he die? And every day, the whole country is like a big camp. 6 o'clock, sad music come on for a month. And you're supposed to cry when you hear the sad music. Otherwise, you're not politically correct. But we were truly sad because we did not know what to believe anymore. When the party come out to say, sorry guys, Chairman Mao is human. He made a mistake. 10 years cultural revolution is a mistake. It's like, wow, my generation is totally lost. What do we believe now? You know, he was like our religion for 10 years. And that's my girlfriend, you can see here, no red scar. She was born into bad family. Here's what communist government do in China. They divide all citizens into 10 classes, 5 red and 5 black. So if you were born into black family, land owner, country revolutionary, property company owners, you don't get to join any of Mao's organizations. You have black spot on your file. I got to join and move up because my dad was orphan, even though his dad had land, but sell his land to treat his mysterious disease. So that my dad, you know, was dirt poor and classified red. That's why I tell American citizens today, don't ever let your government divide us into classes. That's what communists do. We need to be united as American citizens. It's us versus, you know, big government. So it doesn't matter, you're brown, I'm yellow, black, white. We're all American citizens. We have common interests to bond us together to keep this country as a free country. Let's not demonize each other. Let's talk to each other as regular citizens. Otherwise, you'll be like China, divided by government, and they conquer us all at the end. And this is my elementary school, actually middle school graduation picture. When Mao died, school was reopened. We had a new dream. The new dream is to go to university now. College is reinstated. So that's our new goal. To be eligible to go to state universities, you have to study to test for entire high school career. It's all about passing 3 days nationalized college entrance exams. That means I have to pass those exams in order to go to college. So that becomes my new focus. But before that, they give us standardized tests for seventh grader. If you score high, you go to fast track. If you score low, you are mentally deficient, you are late boomer, you have bad grades, you go to loser's track, so-called slow track. At age of 13, your government already told you what kind of career you should have, what kind of college you should go to, or you're going to become workers and peasants, have no hope for you. I remember some of my friends' facial expressions were so sad. They are 13 and their feet is sealed. They have no second chance. You go to slow track, you will never have shots at college. I went to fast track. I score high on the test. And this is my eighth grader picture. This is a vile internet picture. I use this picture for my student file. That's how Chinese government track you from birth to death. When you are born, your parents are supposed to register any new family member through household registration system. If you're married, you have somebody dead, you have somebody new member, you go register in the local security bureau. So they have whole household information about you. Then when you become student, every student has a student file. This student file documents everything about you. You're never allowed to see what's inside. Your parents are never allowed to see it. It's a secret file shared by all government agencies. After you become employee, you graduate, it goes with you, becomes personnel file. Personnel file travel with you until you die. Even today, with this file, if you don't have this, you are not accepted to go to another city to work, then your legal status still is where your file is. Now you know why Chinese, 1.4 billion of them are so afraid to be anti-government? Because you're trapped to death. They know everybody in your state and family. So if you become anti-government revolutionary, guess what? You put your entire extended family at risk. They know who they are, where they live, how much they make, what religion you have, because you have to register all of them. So this is my middle school student file picture. It's not just a file, it's an updated picture. Every year you turn over, so they know what you currently look like. Here's our revolutionary dance.
That was only this we could do. You know, it's called a red dance. You show your love, your affection for your country, for Chairman Mao, for Communist Party. We dress up like a e-minority that time to sing, to dance, to thank Chairman Mao for saving minority people from poverty. And we had fun, but since that was only dance we could do, instead of singing Peking opera, you know, which is very sharp, high pitch voice. And here's me. I always like to sing and dance, but we sure did not have lots of choices. So when I had the chance to listen to classic music in my neighbor's place during news break, I remember it was like a rain come down, you know, on the desert. We were too poor to afford the radio, so I would say, hey neighbor, would you mind? I just listened to 5 minutes and your radio for a classic music when it's supposed to be time come on. And I just remember that forever. I sing like a violin or classic symphony. That's why I still love classic music today. Contrast with what we used to sing and dance with. We were too poor to have a radio, but as a best student, you go to government-sponsored military summer camps. You go march, then you play military-style shortwave radio. That was my fun at age of 16. You know, of course, you gotta ignore all the political propaganda, military marching, and just play whatever gadgets you wanted to play with. And this is my graduation for middle school. Then we take another round of statewide standardized testing. Then you get to pick. If you score high, what is the high school? What is the best high school you want to go to that have a shot for college? All my friends are pretty smart in this class. They pick the good high school to go to. And here's me smiling. Under a totalitarian regime, if you smile too much, you get criticized. I remember people challenging me all the time. Why are you smiling today? I said, I don't know. I said, I feel good. Today's sky is blue, clouds are pretty. You're not supposed to smile. You're supposed to look like everybody else. I guess I was born to be libertarian, but I did not know it. I like to smile. And nothing can make me look like everybody else. Like my friends even, a best writing student could not smile even for their picture. Because all our life we're told, when you're supposed to smile, when you're supposed to cry, when you're supposed to say love. You can only say love publicly about a political regime, about your supreme leader or emperors. If I say I love my family, I like that boy, no. You will be denounced. You will have a dark spot in your student file. She's got lifestyle problem because I like boys. So you cannot say anything like that. Love publicly is only for your motherland, for your party, for your communities, and for your supreme leader, worship Chairman Mao. This is my graduation diploma, actually from high school. 1981, June, I graduated. You can say there's another updated photo of me to be put in my student file. So I can go to college and they can look at my file to know exactly about me. When I lived in the commune, which is public housing, our doors were wide open. I have never heard of concept of privacy, or private property ownership, or private company. That's something I had to learn after I came to this country. Our teachers, principal, do home visits regularly. Come in, talk to my parents, make sure we are politically loyal to the regime. And the Communist Party members, we call them a block, Communist Block Committee. They're our neighbors, but they belong to Communist Party. And they live in our neighborhood. And they can come in, sit in your bedroom, talk to you. I say bedroom because we only have 2 rooms apartment. There's no living room, there's no separation, just 2 rooms. You sleep in there, and you eat there, you read books there, you do homework there. The worst part is like after you fall asleep, police can come kick your door. Our door, the lock is very weak. It's like the public bathroom lock you have. Anybody can kick open. But when they kick open, you just feel so scared, like, now what? Never heard of concept of search warrants, due process, nothing. Just the police camp, something bad is happening. As a child, I was so scared. You know, something wrong with our commune, with our family, they're gonna take somebody away. They were so scary. They just kick. They use their foot. Come on, open the door! You were like sleep as a child during mid-flight. If you're afraid of police state, imagine you live like that all your life. So when I graduated, I was barely 17. I got accepted to go to Shanghai Law School. The reason I wanted to go to law school so bad because my teacher told me his sad life story. He was fresh college graduate during the 50s. And he come to his party to say, come on, college kids, give us true feedback. We value your feedback. They were naive. They believe the government. They gave true feedback. They get on blacklist. Then they got sent to countryside to be re-educated by peasants. He ruined his health by working hard manual work. And he told me at the age of 17, really, our country ruled by men, not by law. That's why I'm the shape I am today. And that just hit me. Maybe I can go to law school, a best university in China. I can transform my motherland into society, ruled by law. Very ambitious, huh? So I basically got enrolled by law school at the age of 17. Chinese law school is 4 years college, not JD. And before I went to law school, we climbed this mountain. You can see Sichuan Mountain. This is Buddha's mountain. And you hear Buddha's chanting. The temples were reopened, and we can now play guitar instead of singing revolutionary songs. That was not my guitar, my friend's guitar. And so it's like China's changing. You know, the economical reform start to open doors. So we start to have different even music choices. I was raised as Buddhist. My mother, my grandmother were Buddhist. But during cultural revolution, you could not dare to go to any temples, worship any gods. The only god you're supposed to worship is Chairman Mao, is Communist Party leaders. If you go to your temple to pray to your own god, you will never join Young Idea or Red Guard. You will be politically incorrect. So our temples were shutting down, but after the Deng Xiaoping's economical reform, we could go back to our temples again. So before my trip to China's Shanghai city from Chengdu, it's like from Austin, Texas to New York. It's a 3 days train ride on hard seat. So I feel like I need some blessing. First time I'm gonna leave my home to go somewhere I have no friends, somewhere new. So I want to ask for blessing. Quickly become shocker. It should be not be shocker for me. When you go to college, they give you a big piece of paper. It's called a freshman registration paper. Then they ask you all those lists of all your extended relatives, your grandparents, your uncles, your aunts, your cousins. What's their name? Where do they work? Who they work? How much do they make? Are they religious members? Or are they communist members? Everything about your extended family. I forgot about this until last year I went to China for my law school reunion. As a souvenir, my friend who had the internal connections with the personnel department got us this copy as a souvenir for sentimental reasons. They even did not think about it. This is the way of their life. When I got this piece of paper, my heart was very heavy. I walked by the personnel file department, which is a big building on campus today. You know, I just feel so sad. Only Chinese today still accept the way they're living in. Totally controlled by the government, no privacy. But they don't challenge it. They never think about it. They think, hey, look at you. You were 17, look at your picture here. There's something laughable about, something like a good memory to treasure. It's like a, So many people in China is because they were controlled by government. There's no freedom of press, freedom of speech. If they are not politically active, doesn't matter how much education they get, doesn't matter how many millions of dollars they make today, they do not know they are slaves. And China is changing. First time I had an encounter with Santa Claus. I was in college. And one Chinese guy dressed up like Santa Claus, ho ho ho, come to say hello, pass out gift. I was wildly amazed. Here's me with eyes wide open. I did not give gift that day. But I was amazed. Oh, there's such a thing as Santa Claus? They give gift to you out of love and compassion, did not expect anything to return? Because in China, if somebody gave you gift, you need to write down. You need to buy something to return them back. It's called return the favors. Otherwise, you will never get a gift again. But Santa Claus did not expect that, so I thought that was amazing. What concept? I still have one funny feeling today about Santa Claus. You know, that even though I didn't grow up with Santa Claus, I wish he was there when we were starving. You know, recently we heard about news about Venezuela people are eating cats and animals, and I told people, I feel sorry for the people there. Have you ever had a rat? We were starving under Chairman Mao's regime. I remember my uncles and I had to figure out best way to trap rats. So we can catch rats, burn the meat, and just have a little bit of protein. Of course, I remember there was not much meat. It was very lean also, and bones. But hey, still better. Even black beans were luxury we could not afford. We were so starving, it stripped humanity out of you when you were starving. I had to raise pets, like we would buy baby bunnies to raise them to be big rabbits, then kill rabbits for meat. I become attached as a child to the rabbits. Hey, but what can you do? You were starving. You swallow your tears to eat those rabbits. That's what's happening today, woman. So I always tell people, especially if you support socialism, have you ever tried rat meat? I don't want to ever eat rat meat again. So this is a college picture, bunk beds up and down. And we were hungry at night, passed crackers. My girlfriend lived in Shanghai. My home is thousands of miles away. So I could not go home on the weekend to get some food. So she would bring some food and we would share at night. Our college is military camp, 6 o'clock, loudspeakers, news and political sounds. Everybody get up, exercise, get ready to go to the classroom, no privacy. The only fun we have is play deck of cards. No radio, no TV, and I still like to play cards today. I learned Texas Hold'em. And playing poker used to be my hobby, but now my cause is a liberty activist. I gave that up. This is an interesting picture in history. First time in college, we had this soccer game. The Chinese team won a soccer game. We started with celebration. You know what college students do? We burn fires, so we get some bushes, and you know, we want to yell loud and celebrate. And those soccer game victory celebration becomes a movement. That night, for the first time in my life, I took off the street with a group of students. We were yelling freedom, democracy, human rights. We were suppressed for so long. If we had a chance, so we wanted to hear ourselves screaming from our lungs. Like first time I really screamed that loud. I did not go to my dormitory to sleep until 2 a.m. My roommate almost called the cops on campus. You're supposed to be in bed, your curfew is 10 o'clock at night. I didn't show up until 2 a.m. So by the time I went back, she said, I almost called cops, I was worried about you. She's a very communist-minded. Where do you go? Oh, this is the best day of my life. I went to straight. We were yelling, chanting, freedom. She looked at me. You're crazy, don't come home so late next time. Yeah, otherwise I'll call cops on you. Now, China become richer after economic reform. We start to have color pictures. This is George. He's an American exchange student visiting my university. He's the guy I'm indebted to today. He changed my life. He showed me a pocket, Declaration of Independence and the American Constitution. I was probably 20 years old. In my entire life, I never heard those words. All men are created equal. I have a natural right given to me by my creator, not by my government. Wow, what a concept. What a musical word to my ears. You want to admit foreign professors or students, you have to register your name, your class, and your address to go to visit them. So I learned quickly, I don't want to be registered anymore. I will take advantage of old lady when she goes to pee or goes to pour a cup of hot tea. I will sneak in to go to see this foreign student. Tell me more about America. Tell me about, you know, a new constitution. My English wasn't good enough, but I remember those words strike me. It's like a light bulb just came on. Wow, this is a country I would like to live in someday if I have to leave China. So he put something in my head. There is a free country called America. You have guaranteed rights as an individual. Government will leave you alone. So I lost in touch with him, but I still remember. Without him, I don't know. Maybe I will be, you know, stay in China longer. So I had a big dream to transform China. By the time I graduated from law school, I was offered one of the 5 spots to stay in university to teach as a faculty member because we were the first graduation class. We had 60 students, 20 girls, and I thought, hey, stay in Shanghai teach is not bad because I like Shanghai, Chengdu is more isolated, and also I can start to practice the law on the campus with my dean who is consulting with Chinese companies. So I become manager for the on-campus law firm. I was teaching students. That's when my dream got crushed after I graduated from law school. Every law school, every department has communist committees. And the boss of committee is the one who controls everything. My dean is only responsible for academics. So you have to join Communist Party, otherwise you cannot stay in law school to teach. Because when we went to college, they told us the purpose of law is not about protect rights. It's about governing class's tool to use that to govern the people. So we become very disfranchised as law school students. So why is that? Well, our professor said, you know, we don't control reality. I'm just teaching you the theory. But even the theory is Soviet Union law model. I become so disappointed after I graduated. I was told, I'm a faculty member now, and I need to act like one. I should not go to dancing party with my students anymore. Even though I was barely 21, my students, 19, 20 year old, they were my friends. But I said, boss, this is my personal time. Why do you care? He said, because it's not politically correct for a faculty member to go dance with the students. And also, I had a Chinese boyfriend in Shanghai. I was told, you cannot go to visit your boyfriend's family because you are not married. So all that personal freedom infringement, he was driving nuts every day. It was like in my hair every day. Say, look, I got a suit, I got a haircut and permed. I try to look more mature, but still not good enough. He was constantly supervising me every day. That's when I realized, my dream of transform China into rule of law society is not going to happen. They're going to take every soul out of me, all the spirits out of me, to make me a different person. But at that point, after I went through cultural revolution, I could no longer be an oppressed little girl anymore. So I was looking for options. And China was opened up that time to American universities. I couldn't apply to go to graduate school. The problem is, in order to leave China, my communist boss have to give me permission to leave. Otherwise, I cannot go apply for my passport. So I was fighting my communist party boss throughout the first 2 years of my faculty career. Then I had to ask him to leave to give me permission. I better change the strategies, right? So I start to stop fighting, stop arguing. I start to smile to him every day. To say, boss, I need to go to the United States to get a graduate degree so I can do my job better. Could you give me a permission to go to apply for passport? So after several months working with him, smiling all the time and kiss butt, and he told me, okay, you can leave, but you have to sign this contract. The contract says, I must go back to China after my graduate degree, or you have to be kicked out of the party. Oh, no problem. Who cares? I was forced to join anyway. But then, another one is extremely critical. Remember I told you about personnel file. If I don't go back to China, my personnel file from Shanghai will be transferred back to my hometown in Chengdu, which is second-tier city. Shanghai, like Beijing, is first-tier city. What does that mean to your residential status, your career? I can never work in Shanghai. I can never go back to my old job. And in my file, there's a dark shadow who say I never go back. Today, if you get a job in Shanghai, you are from Chengdu. It will take you 10 years to transfer your official residential status from Chengdu to Shanghai. That's how tightly controlled society is. You have all the floating populations working illegally or in transit in big cities. But you have to have an official status in order to get the benefits. That's how hard it is to go to big cities. I had to sign it. In order to leave, I had to sign it. I went to apply for my passport 7 times. Every time I was treated without dignity, without respect. This one I was a traitor. Why do you want to go to America? It's an imperialist country. Don't you love your motherland? That's what officials tell me at the Security Bureau. I had to sell my lips, stop fighting, because I knew I had to leave. I must do everything I could to leave. So 2 times after that, to go get my visa. Actually, this is May 11th, 1988. 2 months before my 24th birthday. My happiest day in my life, I landed in Austin Airport. Shining city of the hell. That's what America means to me. I flew 23 hours. I was airsick. I did not look that healthy when I come here. But I still smiled. I was so happy. I had $100 borrowed from my friends. I could not speak English very well. I owe my professor $1,200 in debt because he applied for all my graduate school, paid for my air ticket. I didn't care any of that. I had no friends, no family here. I just had a big dream. My big dream is called American Dream. It's for freedom and the prosperity in this new country. My husband is here today. We met the first night I come to America. Well, he just waiting around for a girl to show up when he was about 29. So I went through all the missionaries to come here, deliver myself to his door for free. So I would say, hey dear, what were you waiting for? I said, I don't know. I'm just waiting for a perfect girl to show up. So 2 days ago, we just celebrated our 26th anniversary. I think, when you say it was a fate, there's nothing to say about fate. It's just ever since I came to America, I feel happy. I knew I had to work hard. I could not understand my professors talking during class. My English was bad. I did not know how to pay my bills. I stayed with host family, exchanging for cooking, and so I could stay there for free. But I had a big dream. If I work hard, if I save money, I can live comfortable life. Later, we went back to China since we're out of time, so I'm going to go through pictures with you very quick. That's the old countryside to jump back to my family's courtyard in the Chengdu village to visit. That's the 1990s. See how poor people were in China. After I become citizen, every time I voted, whenever I could. So my first time I voted, I had to exercise my citizen's rights because I never had that right in China to vote. And this new China, after economic reform last fall, modern condo now, Chengdu's in, you know, like the subway, very nice. Market economy works. We were eating rats under to my mom. Now we have high-rise condos. And this is my uncle's Uber competitor friend. We have Uber in China. We also have Uber's Chinese competitor. I use their cars all the time to go to, you know, running around in China. Hey, what happened to my... What happened? So that's a mover. You see old housing, my grandfather's courtyard next to the new housing. My grandma's mountain village, poor village becomes tourist spot. If you ever go to Chengdu, that's place to go visit. Build around the natural creek. My aunt's old housing is coming down and she's gonna move to those new high rises. Mimic the market reform lifted 600 million Chinese out of poverty. Do you really want to American going back the wrong way, where China is becoming more market economy? It's nuts, right? If you live through some socialism communism, you know what that means, you know, to have economical freedom. This is my old university campus nearby area. It used to be poor village. Now it's a very rich commercial city. Everywhere you go, Chairman Mao statue is still there. Chinese have become more wealthy, but the Mao statue has not changed. I like to say that those statues all come down in my lifetime. This is what I believe. I love our founding fathers. You know, that's, you all know the quote. I become a big believer in libertarianism now, because that's what I believe. I can't really conflict with this philosophy. You know, I have my right, freedom, live my life anyone I see fit, without oppression, without control from my government. And this is my famous AR-15 picture, if I'm not seeing. That's my own AR-15. I will never be one again. Thank you so much. So please tell me if you contribute. There is my contact information. I need your help to tell me to win this race. I will be the first U.S. Senator from mainland China, a communism survivor. What a message you send out to the entire world. We're not buying you government crap anymore. We're sending first communism survivor to your Senate, and she will fight for our freedom, and she will never sell out. So LilyForLiberty.com, go to my website to donate, to contribute. This is a grassroots campaign. Help me to win. I have been fighting freedom all my life. And I want you to trust me. I will fight for your freedom, for your children's freedom, because I've been fighting that entire life. Thank you very much. Have a great day.